Very, very good morning to you all here at Forest Town Church. If you're still up at the back, come and take a seat. There's lots of lovely seats right in the middle at the front if you'd like to come and join us. We're going to make a start in a second. Very warm welcome also to those who are watching online. It's good to have you with us, and it's great that we can share the service with you over this amazing medium called the internet. It's amazing. So this morning, just to let you know, Ant and Helen are on annual leave this week and this Sunday, so I'll be leading the service. My name is Ed Chan, and I'm one of the elders here at this church, and it's a real wonderful thing to be able to continue our celebration of Easter through our series this week. So we have Michael Hunter, who's going to be preaching to us this week, this Sunday, which is great. We're going to be encouraged by him. And just to let you know, the kids are staying in the service today. There are some activities. Rachel, at the back of the hall near the map, has got some activities for the kids to do during the service. So please, parents, you can go to that desk at the back and you can pick up some activities for them. But Fuse will be going outside, so the teenagers from year 9 up to year 13 will have a session this morning, and they'll be going out during the after the songs and worship. It's my joy just to remind us again this morning that we are in the season of Easter. And over Easter weekend, last week, we really got to celebrate so many of the wonderful things that Jesus has done for us in this life and for our salvation. And this, we're going to continue that as Michael's going to preach later, but we're going to sing and celebrate this morning also all that Jesus has done. So why don't you stand with me, and we're going to invite the team, Johnny and his team, to lead us in song worship. But as we do, let's remind ourselves again all the things that Jesus is reminding us of in the last few weeks, that he is our salvation, he is our atoning sacrifice for our sins, he is our hope for the future, both now and for the future. So as we do that, Lord Jesus, we just worship you. We thank you, Lord God, that you are the one who came to us when we weren't looking for you. You are the God who poured out your life that we might find life in you and turn to you. So Jesus, we worship you this morning and invite you to come. Wherever we are, whether we know you intimately, whether we are hearing about you for the first time today, Lord Jesus, would you reveal yourself, because you are alive and you're living. You are not in the grave, but you have risen and you are alive. So we welcome you, and we want to invite you to come and make yourself known to us. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen.
Silences the enemy. Let praise be a weapon that conquers all anxiety. Oh, let it rise. Let praise arise. We sing your name in the dark and it changes everything. We sing with all we are and we claim your victory. Oh, let it rise. Let praise arise. Lift him up. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. They cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. Creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. Oh,
sing, let faith.
Let faith be the song that overcomes the rage and sea. Let faith be the song that calms the storm inside of me. Oh, let it. See you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. They cannot survive when we praise you. The God of breakthroughs on our side. Forever lift him high. With all creation cry, God, we praise you. Oh, we praise you. inside. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. Oh, this is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise you. This is what living looks like. This is what freedom feels like. This is what heaven sounds like. We praise you, we praise. We'll see you break down every wall. We'll watch the giants fall. They cannot survive. Jesus bled and he died for me. I see his wounds, his hands, his feet. My Savior on that cursed tree. His body bound and drenched in tears, they laid him down at Joseph's tomb, the entrance in by heavy stone. Messiah still and all alone. Oh, praise the again.
This is our story. Why don't we sing this again? You shall return.
You shall return in robes of white. The blazing sun shall pierce the night, and I will rise among the saints. My gaze transfixed on Jesus' face.
Praise the name.
Your I've got nothing new. How could I express all my gratitude? We could sing these songs as we often do. Every song must end, you never do. So I throw up my hands, I'll praise you again and again. All that I have is a hallelujah, hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing. I've got one response, I've got just one move. With my arms stretched wide, I will worship you. So I throw up my hands, I'll praise you again and again.
Say it one more time. I'll throw up my hands.
I'll throw up my hands. I'll praise you again and again. So that I have is a hallelujah. Hallelujah. And I know it's not much, but I've nothing else fit for a king, except for a heart singing. So come on, my soul, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those eyes. Get up and praise the Lord.
Here we go.
So come on, my soul, oh, don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those eyes. Don't you get shy on me, lift up your song. 'Cause you've got a lion inside of those eyes. Get up and praise the Lord. Yeah. Praise the Lord. So I throw up my hands, I'll praise you again and again. So fit for a king, except for a heart singing hallelujah, hallelujah, hallelujah. I'll never stop singing your praise, Jesus, for all you've done. You've changed.
Start to speak out something that's in our heart. If you're new here, just want to encourage you, we're just singing something that God's put in our heart, a song of thankfulness. Whether it's just a word, something that you're grateful for, just tell him that he's good, tell him that he's great.
Poured out on the feet of Jesus, we love.
Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord, all my soul. I will praise the Lord as long as I live. I will sing praise to my God while I have my being. Put not your trust in princes, in the Son of Man, in whom there is no salvation. When his breath departs, he returns to the earth. On that very day, his plans perish. Blessed is he whose help is the God of Jacob, whose hope is in the Lord, his God, who made heaven and earth and the sea and all that is in them, who keeps his faith forever, who executes justice for the oppressed, who gives food to the hungry. The Lord sets the prisoner free. The Lord opens his eyes of the blind. The Lord lifts up those who are bowed down. The Lord loves the righteous. The Lord watches over the sojourner. He upholds the widow and the fatherless, but the way of the wicked he brings to ruin. The Lord will reign forever. O God of Zion, to all generations we'll praise the Lord. Lord Jesus, we recognize when this psalm was written, it pointed towards you as the God who would set us free, as the God who would redeem us, and salvation is found in you alone. And Lord Jesus, we want to say this morning that we love you. We just love you for who you are, your sacrifice for us, for showing us the love of the Father. And we just adore you, Lord Jesus. We look to your beautiful face this morning and find our hope, find salvation, find a way forward when there seems to be no way. You will make a way. So we just offer you our praise this morning, Jesus. All that is fit for a king is our hallelujahs, our worship to you. We just stand before you, our great King, and honor you and worship you and say you are worthy, you are good, you are faithful and true, and we love you from the depths of our souls to the song that is on our lips. We love you from the thoughts of our minds to the actions of our hands. Lord, we want to say that we love you. We offer you everything this morning and say, Jesus, you are worthy. Take your place, Lord, in our lives. Our great and wonderful and awesome King. Worthy are you.
Just get a sense as the Lord is here that he wants to bring his love to release people from anxiety. I don't want to minimize any anxiety. It's something that many of us experience, and it's a really hard thing. But I just feel as the Spirit of the Lord is here that he wants to release something off you. And I just drawn back to that verse where it says, "Perfect love drives out fear," and we believe God is love. He's not just loving, his perfection of love. He is love incarnate. And so as we worship him, as we lift our songs, as we lift our hands to him, I think he wants to bring a sense of freedom and healing from anxiety. So we're just going to sing these words again. Jesus, we love you. And if you want to respond to that, or if you just want to worship him, maybe you want to lift your hands.
Oh, Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the one our hearts adore. Jesus, we love you. Oh, how we love you. You are the you.
Yes, we thank you, Jesus, that in you perfect love is found. In you, hope for the future is found. Thank you, Lord Jesus, when we place our faith in you, you come and meet us. You make a way that is where sometimes we feel there's no way. So, Jesus, we just honor you with that. Pray for these cries of faith, Lord. People have lifted their hands this morning and said, yes, Lord Jesus, we want your perfect love to be our guide, to be our truth, to be the thing that we hold to that will last and will never give up on us. So we declare that this morning. We declare and thank you that your love was shown on the cross. And thank you, Jesus, that we can rest in that this morning. And we thank you as we gather now as a family to just welcome each other, that we may share that love as well, that we may encourage each other, that we may find strength, Lord, for today, because you are here and your truth is here and you are here by your Spirit. Just love you and thank you, Jesus, for this time. Amen. 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 Wow. It's a wonderful sense of God's Spirit with us this morning, and we don't want to lose that. We want to just keep our faith engaged with knowing that Jesus still wants to speak to us. He wants to meet us in his word and in fellowship together. But just as part of our worship, as we share this time, I want to encourage you to turn around, have a look around you, someone maybe you haven't met before, and just welcome them this morning as a family. Let's do that. Let's just welcome each other into the Lord's house this morning and encourage them. Wonderful. It's lovely to see you all this morning. I don't know, it's hard for us to gather back together. As always on a Sunday, this is just part of the DNA of our church. But yeah, we just want to encourage you just to find a seat, and we'll have plenty of time this afternoon to have a cup of tea and to welcome each other again. Okay. Okay, yeah, again, a very, very warm welcome to you here at Forest Town Church, for whether you're watching online with us or whether you're here in the building with us. If you are new here to Forest Town Church, we want to really just welcome you again and extend our love to you, and we're so glad you can make it this Sunday. My name's Ed, and I'm one of the elders here at this church. I help to lead alongside Ant and Helen, and if you weren't here at the beginning, I just mentioned that Ant and Helen are on our annual leave this week. Like a school teacher. I know it's half term. It's really a great joy to be here with you this morning. And Ant and Helen are on annual leave, so please pray for them. Pray that they'll have a good rest, and they'll be back with us next week. Just as part of our worship this morning, we want to encourage you to continue your generosity in giving to the ministry of this church. As a Christian, as people of believers, we believe that the church is what God has established as the way for his kingdom to come through. So we want to encourage you, as we do that, as we give financially of our money, that's part of our worship to him. And as we give with joy and with generosity and gratefulness, knowing that when we give, he will do what work he's going to be doing through the ministry of this church. So maybe we can just do that this morning. We can give either online or you can give physically. There's a box at the front and the back which allows you to give in that way as well. But as we do, let's remind ourselves that every good and perfect gift comes from our Father in heaven. And as we give, we don't give out of a need or because there is the, you know, some pressure to that, but we'd give out of joy because of all that Jesus has poured into our lives. So let's remind ourselves of that and let's pray together. So Father, thank you that it's out of your generosity, out of who you are, the God of love, who chose to pour out all that you had so that we might find life and salvation. Thank you for Jesus, the greatest gift to us. And thank you for your Holy Spirit that you sent, Lord, to be the one who is with us and will never leave us or forsake us. So we thank you, Lord God, that as we gather this morning, as we give our tithes and offerings, thank you, Lord, they are would be offerings of worship to you. That we give, Lord, with our whole heart, our whole lives, that you may use it, Lord, for your name's sake, Lord Jesus, that you might be known in this place and in this city and in this country and in this world. We pray these things in faith, knowing that you will do your work in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. A real thanks to Johnny and the team for leading some worship as well. Let's give them a quick round of applause. It's always funny in the church calendar, Christmas and Easter are always the busiest times for our church staff with so much going on. So we want to just honour them and really thank them for all their hard work, especially as they hopefully can find a bit of time off as well in this next season. But yeah, we want to just thank them, but also we want to just let you know about a few things that are coming up in our church in the next few weeks. There is no Dawson Compendia store today, but there is a newcomer's lunch. So if you are new to the church or you've been coming for a while, we just want to offer you a lunch after service on the 21st of April, and it's an opportunity to just come along and to meet some of the people in the church and just have a nice meal with a great catering team who are always with smiling faces, serve up a wonderful feast for us every time we have one of these lunches. So if you're new, then please either sign up. If you filled in already like a newcomer's name list, then we have your details and we'll email you about the coming lunch. But if you're new here today, then please don't go leave this day until you've actually mentioned that to somebody or said hello to somebody, and we'll get your details and hopefully we can invite you to this lunch also in a few weeks' time. Sunday at 6, that is coming up on the 21st of April as well. So we have an evening service that runs from 6 p.m. During the kind of the major school term times, and it's been on pause during the Easter break. So we look forward to that restarting again in a few weeks as well. And that's really our notices. Isn't that wonderful? It's nice and sweet. Except for Johnny's notice.
Sorry, I'm going rogue and I forgot to tell Ed that I was going to do this. But we have a student event on Friday and I just want to make sure all the students know about it. So we're going down to Battle Boom Bar in Watford and we're going to go axe throwing. It's going to be a lot of fun. I've never done it, but I'm sure it's a lot of fun. It looks fun. So I'm going to have to book that quite soon. So if you're a student or a young adult, kind of in that age bracket, it's not just for students, then do come along. And then we're going to go to the mall afterwards for just some food. So please let me know if you're wanting to come on that.
And there's also church on Sundays as well as axe throwing. But that sounds amazing. And I'm sure you'll definitely build relationships together through axe throwing. That's amazing. I might throw out my back if I tried it. But anyway, fantastic. I'm going to invite up Michael Hunter, who's been part of our church, him and his family. It's Beth Ann, Maddie, MB, and McKenna. And Michael's going to come up and preach to us today. Before I do that, Fuse, who are our youth group from years 9 up to 13, they're going to head out upstairs. So bye-bye, young people. Fantastic. I'm just aware that as we end Easter and we go into the summer term, that a few of these guys have got major exams coming up, as well as obviously our students as well at university. So do encourage them to continue to pray for our young people and students as they go through the upcoming summer term with events like exams and things, and that they will do their best of their abilities and glorify God in those things. So yeah, just remember them as well. Michael, let me just pray for you.
Yeah.
And thank you, Jesus, that for your word, which is life to us. We want to hear your voice this morning, Lord Jesus. We want to hear the voice of the Father. And I ask, Lord, that you would come now and just give us ears to hear, give us faith to believe, and give Michael, Lord, words that would just encourage us and bless this community. In Jesus' name I pray. Amen. Amen.
Thanks, Ed.
Sorry,
I have to make room so I can throw an axe. Dude, we could set that up right over here. How good would that be? One Sunday, let's get this, let's make this happen. Yes, you guys in on throwing some axes? All right. So, Easter break. Anybody taking advantage of Easter break to sleep a little later? Yes? Yes? My children have become experts at hibernation. They can sleep. I mean, if it was a competition, I'm telling you, they would be placing high up. They can sleep a long time. But someone asked me, do you like it when your family's together over Easter, or are you ready for your kids to go back to school? I don't know. What is your answer? Mine is, I absolutely love it when my kids are home. I love it. I love being able to watch TV shows. There's a new Alex Rider. Anybody heard about Alex Rider? We are binge watching Alex Rider right now together as a family. I love doing puzzles and hanging out. It's just, it's important to me, and I love getting time with my family. And I think I'm realizing as I get older that part of the reason this is so important to me is because I didn't do it when I was a kid. I missed it. I think that I have three much older brothers, and so when I was born, I just think my parents were tired. They were just like, okay, we've done three. We didn't know you were coming along. We'll do the best we can, but man, we're a little tired here. And then I had another brother, so there's five boys. So you can understand why my parents are tired? I mean, they gave birth to a basketball team, right? Not a tall basketball team. But a basketball team nonetheless. And my mom, all 5 foot, she's now 4'10". She was 5 feet. They won't allow her to measure her anymore. She said, 5'10", 4'10", that's it, we're done. Can't measure me. She's 94, people. My mom is 94. 94 years old. We were together at Christmas, my whole family. My mom's amazing. But I love being together with my family because I think that, to be honest, can I be honest with you guys? Can I be real? I was always scared of my dad. I just was. I think it was, he had a tone, he was kind of loud. I don't know where I get my voice from. And he was just a little scary. He was a little intense. And so I feel like I missed out on a really healthy, joyous relationship with my dad. And I'm realizing, you guys know the languages of love? You guys know those, the five languages of love, how you show love? I'm a words person and a physical touch person. So I love to hug. So if you see me later in the church and you want to give me a hug, I'm all the way in. I will hug all day. And I love words. I love being encouraged. But my dad was not a physical touch person. He was not a words person. Matter of fact, he grew up where you just kind of, you know, he got married, said, I love you, and said, if that changes, I'll let you know. And it just, that was his generation. It was like, I've already told you I loved you. What do you expect? You got it. Done. But he was an acts of service person, right? He was always working to serve our family. He was always doing the hard work, fixing everything, gardening, going to work early in the morning. But I just, because of our differences, I just never felt loved. I just felt scared. And I hate that. So I fight against that all the time with my own family. I want to make sure they know that as their dad, I love them like crazy. So I think I might overdo it. Every time I see them, I'm kissing them on the head. I'm saying, I love you. I'm getting them hugs. And most of the time, they're okay. But sometimes they're like, Dad, seriously, just, I got it. You love me. Give me some space. But it's important to me because I don't know if everybody gets this or is it maybe it's just me, but I feel like when we talk about God as our Heavenly Father, what filters through our mind is our own relationship with our earthly father first. And if our relationship with our earthly father has been a struggle or non-existent or really difficult, it's hard sometimes to really hear and then believe that there's a heavenly father who actually really does love us. You know what I'm talking about? Are you with me? I was speaking at a camp last month with a whole bunch of young people, and we were talking about dads, and the first girl said, well, my dad died when I was little. I don't remember my dad at all. The second girl said, my parents divorced when I was little. I never see my dad. And then the third girl, with tears in her eyes, said, my dad abandoned us, and I can't forgive him. And I was like, oh. And so sometimes when we talk about God as a heavenly father, for some people, that's tough. And they're trying to believe what we're trying to say, but it's hard to enter in. And Jesus knew this when he was around. He was teaching, and he knew that there was a disconnect on what people thought about God the Father. And so he showed up and was like, I got to fix this. I'm going to teach you something. And Colossians tells us this, that Jesus was the visible image of the invisible God, right? He's the visible image of the invisible God. I hear people talk about it even today. I wish God would just show up. I'd believe in him if he showed up. And I'm like, he did show up. He showed up and he lived among us. His name is Jesus. He showed up and he said, here, touch my hands. Hang out. I'll make you some fish, right? And he showed up, and then this is what he said. He said, when you hear me speak, the words that come out of my mouth, those are coming directly from your Father. When you see the way I treat you, this is the way God the Father is treating you. When you understand how much I sacrifice and love you, this is the way your Heavenly Father loves you. That's what Jesus said. He said, I'm the visible expression of the invisible God. And everything you see me hear me say, and everything you see me do, and the way I treat you, that is the way God loves you. Yes? Matter of fact, when I speak, by the way, just to let you know, it's interactive. You do not need to be afraid of interrupting. You can just be like, woo, let's go. I'm American. We get loud. We whoop. So yes, so just jump in. I love it. So, but Jesus knew that. Was that Stuart? It was probably Stuart. It's all good. So here's the thing. Jesus knew he was not going to just teach, but he was going to tell stories. You guys heard about parables, right? Jesus would tell these parables, and my mentor, Andy, would say, a parable is a story with a point. It's a story that's trying to teach us something, a truth, a principle, something, and really about God. And Jesus, one-third of all of his teachings were parables. They're stories. Did you know that? One-third of everything he used to teach was a story. And we remember these stories. Once we hear them once, they stick with us. Even watching Alex Rider, they were like, oh, this is like the Good Samaritan. And I'm like, see, it's in the middle of culture, the stories that Jesus told 2,000 years ago. And here's the thing about parables. A parable, God, there's going to be someone in the parable that represents God, and there's going to be someone in the parable that represents us in all the parables. So as you read them, you're learning about what God thinks and does and believes, and you're learning about what we can do and understand about God, yeah? So Jesus is with these people, and he begins to teach this parable. We're going to walk through this parable together in a minute. And the context is there's a whole bunch of religious leaders there with him who don't like him, who don't like what he's doing, and are against him. Are angry that he's even teaching. But there's a whole bunch of other people there who are like, I want to hear everything this guy has to say. Everything he says resonates in my heart, and I want to hear even more, right? And they far outnumber the religious leaders who were there who don't want to hear. So Jesus gets up, and he's trying to teach people a truth, and this is the truth. He's trying to teach them that no matter what you've done or what you said or what you thought or where you're coming from, no matter if you're a Jew or a Gentile, no matter what, your Heavenly Father is saying to you, come on, come home. And when we come home, that he's going to run to us and he's going to grab a hold of us and he's going to tell us just how much he loves us. And so he tells this story. It's called The Prodigal Son. You may know it. We're going to read it together first and then I'm going to walk through it. So we put it up on the screen. It says this. This is Luke chapter 15, starting in verse 11. And Jesus said, or he said, there was a man who had two sons. And the younger of them said to his father, Father, give me the share of the property that is coming to me. And he divided his property between them. Not many days later, the younger son gathered all he had and took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. And when he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in the country and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. And when he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise and go to my father, and I will say to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. And he arose and came to his father, but while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion. And he ran and he embraced him and he kissed him. And the son said to him, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to the servant, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and shoes on his feet. And bring the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this is my son who was dead and is alive again. He was lost and is found. And they began to celebrate. We're gonna stop there at this point in the story. It continues. We're going to stop there. Powerful, powerful picture, right? You can say to someone, you have a heavenly father who loves you, but then when you hear it in a picture, in a story like this, it's just like, oh, powerful. Jesus is telling these stories. Now let's just walk through it for a moment. So it starts very familiar. It's almost like once upon a time, right? There was a father who had two sons. And there's loads of stories, by the way, throughout the Bible about a father who had two sons. Loads. Starts with Adam, Cain and Abel, and it goes on from there. And by the way, they're almost always squabbling. They're almost always fighting. Rivals, competitive. No difference here, right? But then he says this, and the audience is they're listening. They're like ready for everything. He says, the younger one said to the father, give me the share of property that is coming to me. Now, in the context here, in this culture, years ago, they knew they were going to inherit the land. And most of their wealth was from their land that they owned and the animals that they owned that lived on that land, right? They didn't have a bank account. There was no Barclays down the road and then have, you know, a pension building up. It was what they had around them. And by the way, that land would have been in their family for centuries. It would have been my father owned it, and before him, his father, and before him, his father, and on. And in this culture, the older son would have inherited 2/3 or the majority of the estate, and he would have inherited it first, right? That's the way it worked. But in this story, the younger son comes and says, I want you to give me my part of my inheritance, and I want it now. I don't want to wait till you're dead. And I don't want the land. I don't want to live here anymore. I just want the money. So in this culture, what this son was doing was shameful, was embarrassing, was disrespectful, was absolutely horrendous the way he was treating his father. This was unheard of. This is not how you did life. But this is what he wanted. I just want the money. I don't care about you. Now, what's even more amazing is the father's response. And he divided up the property between them. No arguments, no pushback, no, I can't believe you're doing this, you're such a jerk. The father just did it. Now, here's what would have had to happen, because it says next, the next words are not many days later. So this happened fast. So the father had to immediately, as soon as he could, and he did, sell property that had been in his family for years and years. And you know as well as I do, if you have to sell something quick, you're not going to get the full value for it, are you? You're going to get a small amount. You're not going to get what it's worth. And you're going to have to sell some of your animals because now you don't have enough room for them. And your entire life is going to change. Can you imagine if your kids came to you right now and said, hey, by the way, we know you own this house. We know you got a pension. We know you got some money. Can you just liquidate everything you have right now? Because we'd like to have it right now. Can you imagine that happening to you today? You get home, you're gonna having a nice meal. Hey, how's everybody doing? Hey, by the way, we want our inheritance today. Can you just sell the house immediately? How would you feel? That is what the son has done to this dad. I don't care about you. I just want my money. And yet the father does it. He sells the property and he gives him the money. That's a powerful picture, isn't it? It continues. Not many days later, this happened quick, the young son gathered all that he had and he took a journey into a far country. And there he squandered his property in reckless living. So the son leaves, and he leaves anywhere they are, and he goes to a foreign country. In other words, he's a Jewish person. He's now going to live with the Gentiles. He is rejecting his family, his culture, his background. He's saying, I don't want to be a part of this anymore. I am leaving. With no plans to return, right? He's gone. And then he gets there, and he's just unwise, stupid, silly, and he blows all of his money. Then it says this. When he had spent everything, a severe famine arose in that country, and he began to be in need. So he went and he hired himself out to one of the citizens of that country who sent him into the fields to feed pigs. Now, be aware that for a Jewish person, they didn't eat pigs. Pigs were unclean. So he's already taking a job that it's like, ugh, for a Jewish person, they wouldn't want to do that. But now he's feeding the pigs. He's just taking whatever job he can get because he needs some money. Because he's in need. And then it says this, and when he was longing to be fed with the pods that the pigs ate, and no one gave him anything, he's starving. He is so hungry. But when he came to himself, he said, how many of my father's hired servants have more than enough bread, but I perish here with hunger? I will arise, and I'll go to my father, and I'll say to him, I have sinned against heaven. And before you, and I am no longer worthy to be called your son. Treat me as one of your hired servants. So here's something, a picture I wanted to give you that someone told me. We were in Israel, and we were talking about where he was and where he went to. And it's amazing to know that the father would have known he went, you know, where he went. He would have known the general vicinity he's in. And he let him go. And what the father didn't do is go into that city and try to drag him home. He gave him a choice. He gave him the freedom to go live a life and make some mistakes. But the picture it gives us in this parable is that the father was looking and hoping and praying that his son would come home. He was always looking in that direction over and over again, hoping, is he going to come home? So then it says this. He arose and he came to his father. But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and felt compassion. And he ran and he embraced him and he kissed him. Now, again, in this culture, the father would have been wearing a really long robe, an older man. And older men culturally would never have run. He would have had to have hiked his robe up above his knees so that he could have run. And that's just not something an older man would have done. But he does it. He can see his son from a long way off. Do you know how you can recognize people, family members or friends, even though they're a long way off, because you just know their tendencies, you know how they do their stuff, and you can see them? Well, the father, long way off, he could see his son. And he was like, that's my son. And he's coming home. So he grabs his skirt up, and he goes running after his son. This is my daughter, if you're wondering. Thank you, Maddie. Perfect. I asked her at 8:47 this morning, can I hug you in church? And she's like, what? He ran to him. A son that had rejected him and told him he wishes he was dead and said, all I care about is the money. But when that son was walking home, the dad said, I got to get to my son as fast as I can. And he embraced him. And then he said he put a robe on him and a ring on his finger and shoes on his feet. He treated him like royalty. That's what you do to royalty. And then he said to his servants, kill the fatted lamb. We got to have the biggest party you have ever had in the history of parties, and we're having it tonight. Because my son who is dead is alive. My son who was lost is found, and he's coming home, and we're having a party. Yes. So are you getting the picture yet? If you are far from God, if you have run away from God, if you are going, I'm not sure I can go home to God. God is big and scary, and he's got a tone, and I'm not sure I can trust him. Here's the picture Jesus is trying to say to you. Come home. You are invited. You are welcome. You are wanted. And when you start coming home, we're coming to you, and we're going to grab you, and we're going to hug you, and we're going to kiss you, and he's going to throw the biggest party of all time. For you, that is the picture of your Heavenly Father that Jesus wants everybody to know. Isn't that a good picture? So whatever your background is, whatever your relationship was like, look at this, doing this with one hand, by the way. That's pretty good. Whatever your relationship was like or not like, with your earthly dad, your heavenly father is saying to you as clear as he possibly can, I am crazy about you. And I just want you to come home. And when you start coming home, I'm coming to you. And we're gonna have a Greek party. And the food's gonna be good, people. And it's going to go on all night long. We're going to do some Lionel Richie all night long. That's what it's going to be like. There's nothing to this. Well, we've been partying for like an hour. Like, should we go to bed? Nope, we're not going to bed. This is going on for a long time. The story continues, by the way. The older brother's mad. Maybe you can relate to the older brother. You're like, I have been faithful. I've been serving you. I am here. I didn't run off and spend all your money. I didn't make you sell your property. And you're going to celebrate this guy. And the older brother's like, he spent all of his money on prostitutes. And you're still going to forgive him? And the father says, yes, I am. Because he's my son. And you should be celebrating too. You need to join the party too. Whatever we may think of our own right relationship with God, here's what we need to understand. There is no sin so big that God's grace can't cover it. And that goes for every single person in this room right now. There is no sin too big that God's grace doesn't cover it. What God is longing for every single person on this planet Earth is for them to come home and come to know and enjoy their Heavenly Father. Come to the end of yourself. Come to the end of thinking, I can do life on my own. I don't need God. I don't need any of these things. Just get to the end of that as soon as you can, like this prodigal son did. Say to the Lord, I am sorry. I've been trying to do life without you, and it's not working. I have sinned against you, and I am sorry, and I'm coming home, and your Heavenly Father is running to you. Yes? Are you with me? So two things, and then we're going to sing a song. One is, if you have never come home, if you have never said, I'm in, I'm coming your direction, Lord, today can be that day. Today. You don't have to worry about it. You don't have to wonder about it. You don't have to think about it anymore. Today is the day you can come home. I went to church as a 21-year-old. I'd grown up going to church. Fell asleep most Sundays. Thought it was a bit boring. But as a 21-year-old, a guy got up in front of a church, and he did a talk like this. And on that day, as a 21-year-old, I didn't walk down the aisle. I ran down the aisle to say, I'm in. Let's go. I want to know. I am saying yes to Jesus. Today can be your day. And the second thing is this. If you are sitting here today and you're going, I'm a Christian, but I have been wondering. I've been trying to live life on my own as much as I can. I'll show up at church on a Sunday, but really, I am in control of my life. Today can be the day you stop doing that. Today can be a day that you come home and say, I'm sorry. I've been running from you. I'm scared of you. And I don't need to be anymore. So here's what we're going to do. Simple as pie. Band's going to come up. We're going to stand up. We're going to sing a song. We're going to have our prayer team and some other folks standing up front. And this morning, today, right now, if you want to say, I'm coming home, either for the first time or for the 10th time, I just want to come home and say yes to Jesus, we're going to do that. You can come up, you can hug somebody, you can pray with somebody. Yep, so I'm going to pray, the band's going to come up, and then we're all going to stand up and sing, and then I'm just going to invite you to come up if you want to. And by the way, I was thinking about it this morning, I'm so glad that when I was 21, somebody invited me to come up. So I'm going to do it today. All right, let's pray. Thank you, Heavenly Father, for loving us. Thank you that you ran to your son who was coming home. And you threw a party. And you kissed him and you hugged him. And you let him know just how much you love him. God, I'm praying for anybody that's sitting in the room this morning going, maybe that could be me. And I'm praying they would say yes today and come home. because you're ready to wrap your arms around him. Pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. We can all stand up.
Spoke a word, you were singing over me. You have been so, so good to me. For I took a breath, you breathed your life for me. You have been so, so kind. Service till you give yourself away. Oh, the overwhelming, never-ending, reckless love of God.
Says
But while he was still a long way off, his father saw him and he felt compassion and he ran and he embraced him and he kissed him. And the son said, Father, I have sinned against heaven and before you. I am no longer worthy to be called your son. But the father said to his servants, bring quickly the best robe and put it on him. And put a ring on his hand and his shoes on his feet and bring the fatted calf and kill it. And let us eat and celebrate. For this is my son who was dead and is alive again. He was lost and he's found. So the prayer team, anyone who wants to come, if you want to come up, come home today. Yep, you guys can just come and stand up front. If you want to come today, come on, come stand. The prayer team can stand up front, yes. If you want to come, somebody pray with you, talk to you, say yes to you, now's the time. So we're just going to, I'm going to pray and then just come home. God, we're praying. You know you are good. You are faithful. You are calling. You're always calling us to come to you. So, God, I'm just praying right now. If there's somebody in the room, anybody that's saying, I want to say yes to Jesus right now, that they would do it. They would come home. If you want to say to the Lord, I'm sorry I've been running. I'm sorry that I allowed the cares of the world to get in the way. Just come on home. Your father is ready to throw a party for you. In Jesus' name, amen. So we're going to have music playing. We're just going to be standing here. If anybody wants to come get prayed with, if you want to get a hug, if you want to say yes to Jesus, we're here and we'll be here.
I've got this picture of a cup, one of those children's cups. I don't know what you call them, sippy cups. I feel that there's people here that have been sipping on God, and God wants to do a lot more. He wants you to open up that cup and start drinking from Him properly. If they feel that you've just been kind of coaxing with your walk with God, then we'd love to pray for you, because God is right here and He wants to do something amazing in your lives.
Thank you, God, for loving us, for running to us. I'm just praying, Lord, that we would all run to you. Thank you for today. Thank you for this amazing story and reminder of the love of our Heavenly Father. We love you. In Jesus' name. Amen. If you want prayer, come get prayed for. If you want to just come hang out, you can go get something to drink. If you want to talk to me or Ed or anybody else, then just come talk to us. But thank you so much for coming today. It's a joy, Forest Town. You guys are amazing.
Thank you, Michael. I just had, just before we end, I just had one verse I wanted to read from 1 John 4, and it says this. This is love, not that we have loved God, but that he loved us and has sent his son Jesus to be the propitiation for our sins. Just remind us that as the love of God is shown in this way, that Jesus was the one who took that sin, that disrespect to God, that dishonor, and bore it on himself on the cursed tree, on the cross. And this morning, if you just want to respond to Johnny's word this morning as well, or John's word just now about those two pictures, we'd love to come and pray for you. You know that God is speaking to you. We're not coercing or anything. We just want to invite you to respond. But there's a prayer team here who would love to pray for you. If any of those things come to your heart, don't miss the opportunity today to respond to what God has been prompting in your heart, we believe. But if you are visiting today, we'd love to invite you to stay as well for a cup of tea and a great coffee in the coffee shop behind. But if we continue to minister into this room, and just invite you just to move out there quietly, just so we give some time and space in this place. So yeah, but thanks for being here today. I want to bless you and pray that the Lord goes with you this week and fills you with much joy as you go out and serve him and honor him in your lives. So bless you guys and have a great week ahead. And thank you to Michael also for serving us this morning as well. So well done. Thank you.